the poverty line is set very low. I mean, for a family of four, it's around $20,000.
Right.
And the way to think about it with regard to homelessness is just think about what the average rent is. And you know your students, and you have to rent apartments. So you know a two-bedroom house, probably about what that goes for, it's actually around $1,200 a month.
Yeah.
That's your entire income then.
Yeah.
That would take up all of your money. So, you know, what it really costs to afford an apartment like that is almost $50,000. And about half of all the households in the state of Rhode Island cannot afford an apartment. So that's the problem. The problem is the rents are spectacularly high. The way I would put it is we mainly distribute housing using a market, and what we have here is a case of market failure. It's failing to distribute housing to close to a majority of the people in our state, you know, in a way that they can afford that housing.
Yeah.
So that's the thing. You know, people think of all the characteristics of homeless people when they think about homelessness and say, well, that's why someone's homeless. Well, no. Think about the failure of the housing market to deliver housing to people in a way that makes any sense in terms of what they can afford.
Walk us through a day of someone who's homeless.
Okay.
From literally start to finish.
Literally.
Do the best
okay.
you can.
I'll say, say someone for the first time experiencing homelessness. Kennedy Plaza is a target, is a main place where people hang out at. You see a lot of people hanging out downtown at Kennedy Plaza. For someone that first becomes homeless, you say, okay, you dropped off. You're there at Kennedy Plaza. Where do you go from there? You have no money in your pockets. You have no way to get around. You have to use the bathroom because that's the problem. You have nowhere to go to use. Where do you go? You're in Kennedy Plaza and you have to use the bathroom. You think maybe I can go to the Biltmore? You're not going to be able to go to the Biltmore because you're homeless, and they're not going to allow you to come into their facility. So you have to find some place. Sometimes that's why you see the alleys or smelling a urine or something like that, and you have to go really bad, so you have no choice. You can also criminalize for that, for using the bathroom, you know, outside. From there, you have to find out, where am I going to go to eat? Before you go, what if you don't even know where there is a place to go to eat? We have this paper called the Street Sites, and on the back of it, it tells you all the different food kitchens that you can go to. For someone that becomes homeless for the first time, they have the Street Sites newspaper. It tells you all the different places that you can go to get food. Now, you have to figure out, how are you going to get to these places? You have no money. You have nothing on you. You're going to have to walk. And then what if you're new to the area? You really don't know much, so it keeps people kind of stuck. And then there's a lot of people that's not even from here also that just got dropped off here, and so it was in a relationship, and it went bad, and now where do they go from there? Well, anyways, you go from that area to try to find out a place where you can go to eat. From there, you got to find somewhere where you're going to go for shelter for the night. And where do you go for shelter for the night? People always think of Crossroads, because you hear a lot about Crossroads on, you know, on the media. You see poster boards of Crossroads, so a lot of people go there, and they kind of let you know different places that you can go to. It's not a shelter, but it's more a referral, you know, for different shelters that's out there that might be open for you to go to. So from Crossroads, they'll send you to a place. You can only go to that place between 4 or 5 at night. So after you go to that place 4 or 5 at night, where are you going to go before that to get some food? Where are you going to go before that to, you want to take a shower? You can't take a shower. Some places in the shelter, you have to, like the McDonald's State Rescue Mission, for example, you have to go through the church system. You have to do all this other stuff before they give you a meal, before they give you something to eat.
Wow.
You have what you were saying, like, so that's their life. Like, just, it's hard to be homeless. Affordable housing, because that's what I feel that is a lack. We have a lack of here in Rhode Island. If we had more affordable housing, then people would be able to live with.
It's called Housing First, because for a long time our policy has been, well, let's make sure that someone's ready for housing. Well, guess what? Everyone is ready for housing. You know, give me the list of people who aren't ready to have a roof over their head. Or the list of people who should be living in really dirty, totally inadequate, barrack-style shelters. That list is zero. There's nobody. So the thing to do is to put people immediately into an apartment, and then if there's any services they need, you associate services with the apartment. I did some research that shows it saves about $8,000 in public funds per person per year to just put people in an apartment as opposed to letting them stay on the street.
An argument I've heard before with people just, you know, almost like the anti-poverty argument is that they're given enough to get by and enough to sustain where they're at, and so that perpetuates, that keeps them kind of in that cycle, in that bubble of homelessness. What's your response to that when someone says, you know, soup kitchens and shelters give them enough, they provide enough, and therefore people can be, not comfortable, but...
They grow dependent on it,
yeah.
I mean, it might be some people that might grow dependent to that, but really, I really don't think that that's enough for people, because, I mean, the soup kitchens, it's not like people have a place to get a meal every day. People do not have a place to get a meal every day. That's why we have the soup kitchen at the State House. That's something that we put together, is because on Wednesdays, people don't have a place to go to get a meal. So how is that really going to help someone? And then they have at night, where are they going to be able to eat? People have to, they don't have a car, they don't have a way to get around. If they do have soup kitchens in different places, if you can't get to that place, you're not going to have a meal for the day. So I don't really think that that's helping. I don't think it's really helping. It's a temporary solution. I mean, some people might be, well, I won't, today I might have to have a meal, but I won't have somewhere to sleep tonight, because if I go there to get some food, I might not make it back there to the shelter.
You can only have so much, yeah.
So it's really not helping. But, you know, homelessness is not a respected person. Mm-hmm. Anybody can become homeless. Anyone is a paycheck away from being homeless, you know. And some students that finish college, you know, if they can't go back to mom and dad's, where are they going to go? They can find themselves homeless, you know, also.
When I was a child, my mom had 6 kids.
Where were you?
I was the oldest.
Okay. I'm the oldest in 6.
Yeah. So I was the oldest, and so I was like kind of the mother too, and I tried to do everything I could to help my mom out. What happened with us is that one day we came home. My mother had a way of like not showing us that, you know, there was a problem.
Yeah.
And so, all I know, one day I came home. We had no lights, but we had candles on. And my mom did, you know, don't turn the lights on. We have candles, like, so we were thinking, like, okay, she's doing something special. So we just have candles, and then come to find out the next day, she's like, oh, we're going to have a picnic. You know, we're going to have a picnic. So she goes out, go gets, you know, this food, and she brings it in the house. So we're having, oh, wow, we have candles. We're having a picnic, you know, not knowing
that.
I was actually in middle school,
okay. So
I was like in the 7th grade. Okay, but she was just like that. She had a way of doing things, and so then after that, she's like, when we came home from school, she's like, she picked us up, and she's like, oh, we're not going home today. We're going to this other place. It's like a hotel, you know.
Wow.
And I'm like,
my
okay.
gosh.
So it was actually a family shelter, and she was like, you can have your, you know, you girls can share this room. The boys can share this room. It was like a 2-bedroom family shelter. I think the system was kind of set up pretty nice at that time. It was supposed to be where the children have one room and the parent have another, but my mom, she was more like, I'll sleep on the couch. I'll give my kids, you know, the bed, so the kids can take this and that one. But the way that it played out in my life was I was not able to have my friends sleep over. I was not able to sleep over my friends, because when you're in the shelter system, you can't sleep out. You know, you can't sleep at your friend's house or anything like that. You have to be in the shelter at a certain time.
Every night?
Every night.
How long were you there for?
We were there for about a year or so.
A year?
Yeah. And Christmas there. And,
really? Yeah. What was Christmas like there?
Well, that particular shelter was pretty nice. They got a lot of donations and things, so they gave the families like gifts and everything like that. They help you save a certain part of your income so that you'll be able to move out and get housing of your own. So you'll save like, 30% of whatever you were getting. You'll give it to them and they will put it in an account for you. And you'll be able to actually move out into your place. And that's what my mom did.
Does this job wear you down a lot? I mean, on a day-to-day basis, dealing with something so, I guess, devastating?
It doesn't really wear me down, but I do try to do as much as I can because when I go home, I still think about it, still on my mind, like, wow, someone's still out there sleeping outside, you know, what can we do? When are they going to wake up and help, you know, in the community? But I wouldn't say it wears me down because, like I said, this is my passion. This is what I strive to do, just make things better, you know, within our community. And that's why when I get up early in the morning to come out to work, that's my strive to get out there to make this community better for others. So.
It probably is when people do get into an apartment, and I talk to them about that, and they basically are so incredibly happy and inspired and feel so great about finally having a place to live. So my efforts are devoted to trying to make that happen as much as possible, and you know, hopefully get to the point where we won't have to do it anymore because everyone will have a place. I think the elections at this point are totally dominated by very wealthy individuals and political action committees.
Yeah.
And so a lot of the issues are what wealthy people and corporations think the issue should be. Not really, you know, the issues that poor people have. In fact, poverty is not an issue.
Yeah.
Really not much of one anyway, except when some of the more prominent candidates made disparaging remarks about the poor. But in terms of a policy response to poverty or a policy response to homelessness, no one said much of anything about it. We actually have a very good national plan to end homelessness, and we're just developing a very good state plan to end homelessness. The problem is we don't have the housing resources to implement them. I mean, you've got this great plan. All you do is carry out the steps of the plan and you end homelessness, but no one's offering the housing or the rent subsidies to make it possible to implement it. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing. I'm still optimistic enough about people to feel if they knew the truth, how many people are homeless, the fact that, for example, 1,000 children in Rhode Island were homeless last year. Most people don't know that. They think it's, you know, simply people who are, you know, doing drugs or drinking a lot. No, 1,000 children. You know, who really even knows that? But I think if people did know more about it, I think they would support us.
How can people help? Donate into local food shelters. Like I was saying, vote for people that care about the issues of homelessness so that we can bring about that change, you know.
People call their legislators, and that would be in the state of Rhode Island if they live in Rhode Island, or wherever they live, and say, we know there's a plan to end homelessness. It's called Opening Doors. There's a federal plan and there's a state plan. And just say, we support, you know, that plan and we want you to provide the resources to implement it. And we know it'll actually save money for taxpayers, not cost money.
Homelessness has no face. It can happen to anyone. It can happen to you. Anyone has no respect of person.